Let's now look at the idea of analysis of variance. Okay, the learning objective is we want to compare more than two population means using the ANOVA, which stands for Analysis of Variance Procedure. Identify appropriate parameters to test and compare based on the data. Again, that's the same thing we've been doing. We saw in the previous sections or previous discussions, when we had two independent data sets, we'd take a look at them, see if they're both normal, use a two-sample T. If one or the other or both were not normal, then we went to non-parametric tests. That's really what this analysis of variance is all about. Only rather than having two, I'm going to have three or more independent data sets or independent populations, and I want to compare the means from each. If they're all normal, if I have the typical normality assumptions, then I can use ANOVA. If not, then I'm going to switch gears and switch to the medians and use the appropriate non-parametric technique. Okay, why use ANOVA to begin with? If we want to compare means from two independent groups, we can use a two-sample t-test. That is, once again, assuming all the appropriate assumptions are reasonably satisfied. If I go to 3, how would I do this? Well, if this is group 1, group 2, group 3, I could do a t-test between group 1 and 2, a t-test between group 2 and 3, and a t-test between group 1 and 3. So I could actually do 3 different two-sample t-tests to get all of the combinations to see, you know, which one's bigger than the others and so forth. Well, what if I had 5 groups? Well, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I could do between, see, 1 and 2, 1 and 3, 1 and 4, 1 and 5, 2 and 3, 2 and 4, 2 and 5, 3 and 4, 3 and 5, and 4 and 5. So that's, my goodness, how many is that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's a bunch. It's a bunch of t-tests. I'm not sure how many is there. I don't really care. It's too many. I don't want to do it. You could spend the whole day doing t-tests, trying to do it two at a time, trying to figure out, you know, who's bigger than the other or any differences, that sort of a thing. That's why we use an ANOVA. An ANOVA takes all of them and all at once makes a comparison and says they're all the same or somebody's different. Now, if somebody's different, ANOVA won't tell you which group is different. Once you know that somebody's different, one of those groups, at least one of those is different from the others, then we have to do a multiple comparison test to try to determine which is different. But initially, to make a determination whether they're all similar or not, we can use an ANOVA. Now, one of the problems of using multiple t-tests is the whole idea of alpha, the probability of type 1 error, balloons on you if I do t-test after t-test after t-test. Think of it this way. If I flip a coin over here, what's the probability that I get ahead? Well, it's a half. If I come over here and flip a coin, what's the probability I get ahead? Well, that's a half. If I come over here and flip a coin, what's the probability I get ahead? That's still a half. If I do it one more time, what's the probability I get ahead? That's still a half. I just did it 4 times as an example. Let's do it one more time, 5 times. If I do it that 5th time, what's the probability that I get ahead? That's still a half. Now, let me ask you this question. What's the probability that somewhere in those 5 flips, somewhere in there, I'll get ahead? Well, you don't have to figure it out. The point is, it's definitely a lot more than a half. So each time I did a flip, the anticipated, the expected probability of getting ahead was 1/2. But the probability of getting ahead somewhere in there is clearly bigger. Well, what if this is not flipping a coin? What if this first one is actually doing a t-test? And I said alpha. Well, that's saying the probability, the maximum probability of getting a type 1 error is alpha. Now I do another t-test. There's another alpha. Another t-test, another alpha. Another t-test and another t-test. There's 5 alphas there. So each alpha would be controlling for type 1 error in each of those t-tests. But what's the probability I commit a type 1 error somewhere in those t-tests? Well, it's bigger than alpha. Well, how much bigger? Well, if alpha is 0.05, this little calculation here will kind of tell us how much bigger. So if I take 1 minus, the quantity 1 minus 0.05 to the 5th, see, this is 0.95 to the 5th. So I have a 95% chance of not committing a type 1 error all the time, or for each one individually. So if I take this to the fifth, subtract it from 1, that should give me back my alpha combined for all of them. Well, if I do this, I get, let me see here, I'll get 1 minus 0.95 to the fifth. This is 0.2262. So what this is actually saying is that if I do 5 t-tests, or 5 hypothesis tests, each using an alpha level of 0.05, which is typically pretty reasonable, combine my actual alpha, combine the probability that I commit a type 1 error is actually going to be more than 22%. 5%, 22%, I don't like it. Is this acceptable? No. I went from a maximum reasonable risk of 5% to a maximum reasonable risk of 22%. No, that's not acceptable. Again, that's where ANOVA comes in. ANOVA takes care of this. If alpha is 0.05, it completes a test based on all 5 of those, 6 of those, 12 of those, 3 of those, whatever you happen to have. And if alpha is 0.05, then alpha is 0.05. That's the probability, the maximum probability of committing a type 1 error, which is rejecting the null hypothesis when you should not. Okay, ANOVA is a technique which will allow us to make comparisons between multiple independent groups. By the way, if you're doing ANOVA on only 2 groups, well, don't. Just do 2 sample T, right? But if you do end up with ANOVA on 2 groups for whatever reason, you get the identical result as you would with a 2 sample T. So that's kind of cool. Specifically, we're going to be work with this ANOVA technique known as one-way ANOVA. This actually says one, although it doesn't really look like it. One-way ANOVA. The one-way ANOVA technique simply says I have one variable with multiple levels. Maybe I have multiple classes. There's my multiple levels. And how they did on this same exam. There's my one variable, the variable being the exam, with multiple levels each class. I can make a comparison with multiple classes, see if they all did essentially the same, or if it looks like one class or another did better. It's called one-way ANOVA because the data has, again, multiple levels of the same variable. Okay, each sample, here's your assumptions, each sample has been randomly independently selected from the population it represents. Okay, that's kind of basic assumption for all of our data analysis. If you're working with univariate data, the basic assumption is that it's a randomly selected in such a way that it's representative of the population. If it's not representative of the population, then why are you doing this? The whole point is to make an inference about the population. So this is really a basic assumption for all the testing that we're doing. Now, the parent distributions, we're talking about the populations now, are all distributed normal. Gosh, this sounds familiar. If we go back to when we first took a look at the one sample t-test, we needed that one sample to come from a normally distributed population. And then later we said, okay, I want to compare 2 independent means. So I took the idea of this one sample t-test and just did it twice, essentially. I needed both of them to be normal. If one or both were not normal, then I went to a non-parametric technique. Well, the ANOVA is a natural extension of that. So rather than 2, I have 3, 4, or 5, or 6, or whatever number of groups that I'm actually going to test. So each of those needs to be normal. If one or more are not normal, then we're going to switch and go to a non-parametric technique. An additional assumption is that the variances of the K samples, maybe I have 3 samples, so K equals 3, 5 samples, K equals 5, the variances are all equal. Actually, we're not worried about them being equal, it's just similar, whether the variances are actually similar. Now, we can satisfy this with an F-test. Well, you've already done this idea with a 2-sample T. When you work with the 2-sample T, you said, all right, I have these 2 independent groups. Okay, good. Now I can continue. They're both normal. Good, I can continue. And then you did an F-test to decide whether the variances were similar. If they're similar, you pooled. Well, the ANOVA pools. I mean, part of the actual calculations for analysis of variance is based on a pooled variance. So we need to pool. This is not saying should be pulled. No, it's saying we need to pull. That's the way the calculations are done. So in order to properly pull, we need similar variances. So we can do an F-test to make the determination in terms of whether or not we are reasonably satisfied the variances are similar. If so, then we've satisfied all of our assumptions. Everything looks good to go. We can actually go ahead and do an ANOVA, which is what we will do in the next section. In the next section, we will take some example data, walk through all the assumptions, make a determination if they're satisfied, complete the ANOVA, or if there are issues, we'll go ahead and switch and do a non-parametric technique.